Well, this is, I think, possibly the best board game ever, which is quite a bold claim. Many people talk about this as just the perfect game. It involves strategy and a little bit of luck as well because of the roll of the dice. It's actually a game which people play together. There's talking all the time. There's trading going on. Sometimes games suffer because the person playing that particular turn is the only person really being involved, and others sitting waiting for them. This one involves everyone. This is called The Settlers of Catan. It was created by a German dentist who also loved board games, and it won the Spiel des Jahres, which is kind of Nobel Prize of gaming in Germany. It's the sort of game which gets a mathematician immediately excited because just look at the layout of this board. It's hexagons, not squares, and hexagons are just such a beautiful shape, and the tessellation of the plane using hexagons. So as soon as I saw this game, I was getting very excited. But you'll see there are also numbers on here. So let me tell you a little bit about how you play the game. So you'll see there are different sorts of squares. There's woodland here, and woodland will generate a different resource of logs. The mine hexagons give you ore. The pasture hexagons allow you to graze sheep. The fields, then we can grow some wheat. And then in the hills, you can dig out stuff to make bricks. And each of these will allow you to build different things. Now, how do you get these? Well, if you own a property and it's on, say, the corner of these hexagons, we're going to see which of these is going to generate some resources in this turn. And I'm going to throw some dice, and I've got 10. So those areas of land which have the number 10 on them will be generating, in this case, 10 is generating a sheep. So this will generate a sheep for anybody who's got a property on the corner of this land. But unfortunately, I've not generated anything because I wanted a 5, 4, and 11. So if I'd been here, I would have got some sheep resources. Interestingly, what's the chance of getting, for example, if I'm here, of getting a 12? Well, unfortunately, there's only one way to get a 12 with two dice, which is a 6 and a 6. And this is what this little dot at the bottom here is telling me, that this is actually quite a hard thing to generate resources from. So is it a good idea to put your property here? Because there's only one chance. Whilst look at 6, for example. This has got 5 dots underneath it. Why? Because, well, to get a 6, how many different ways can I get a 6? There are 5, because I can get a 5 and a 1, or a 4 and a 2, or 3 and a 3, 2 and a 4, or a 1 and a 5. So there are 5 different ways to get a 6, 4 different ways to get a 5. So these little dots actually help you to do the probability in this game, because let's see, you know, if I put a property here, I've got 1 plus 5, 6, plus another 4. That's 10 kind of different ways the roll of the dice can generate things for me here. Let's choose somewhere else and just calculate. Let's go here. That was 10. So here we've got 3 plus 2 plus 4. That's only 9. So this is a less strategic place to put your property because only 9 out of the 36 different things are going to generate resources. So this is what you need to do when you're playing Catan. So a little bit of mathematical strategy here will help you to choose which corners to go on, because you want to add up those dots, because that's telling you the probability, you're going to add up those probabilities that you're going to generate some resources if you put your property there. This is why a little bit of mathematics can help you to play this game.
There must be more to it than just who can crunch the numbers the best, though, to win this game, or...
Well, there's actually a lot of psychology involved, because once you've got resources, you might have found you just generated a lot of sheep, and what are you going to do with all these sheep? And you need to start trading. So that's actually why this game is so beautiful, because it involves a lot of conversations, and I've got loads of sheep, but I want some logs. Will you trade me? And there's a little... And that's not determined by the game. So that's determined by how much you need something and how much you can see your opponent needs things.
Oh, do you have any clay? Will you trade a rock for a clay?
But let me talk about another mathematical aspect of the game, which I think is rather beautiful. It's not about strategy whilst playing the game, but it's about how you set the game up. Because if you notice, this is a lot of hexagons placed down on the board, And I place it down in a particular way. We've got the mines placed here. There are three mines here. But the beauty of this game is each time you set it up, you can lay the hexagons down in a new way each time.
Because these are like, these are modular.
They are. Right. So, you know, we could have set this up such that this was swapped over. And so actually perhaps there's a lot of woodland. You know, we could have a whole great big forest here. So the numbers actually must stay the same, although they can actually kind of rotate. So I was intrigued about, you know, how many different games are in this box? You know, Monopoly, you only get one board, so there's only one game. But there are so many games inside this box because of the permutations you can do. So I thought it might be fun with your Numberphile audience just to calculate how many different boards there can be.
The hexagons can go, can they go anywhere? Is there any rules or restrictions?
No, there are none at all. So
it sounds like it would be quite easy then.
It is quite easy, but there's a little bit of subtlety here because obviously, so you'd say, okay, how many squares are there?
Well, hexagons. Yep. How many?
Oh my gosh, yes, yeah. There's like
how many hexagons?
How many hexagons are there?
Okay, well, 3, 7. What's that? 12, 16. Is that 19?
19, and these are called hex numbers. So hex numbers go 1, 7, 19, and it's the number of hexagons you need. If, you know, if we made, there are expansions of Catan. This is the basic version. Little challenge for Numberphile viewers. What's the formula for, you know, like the a Catan board with N layers? There's a way you can generate these hex numbers. The hex number for this board is 19. There are actually 19 factorial different ways I can lay the hexagons down. So, you know, we can start in the middle. There are 19 hexagons. I can put the first one down there. Then we go around in a circle and then do this circle. So at first sight, it looks like there are 19 factorial different games you can play in the Settlers of Catan. But you have to remember, some of these hexagons are actually the same because I've got three different hexagons which are mines. So actually I could have put these down like this and the board hasn't really changed. It means that these three mines can be permuted around and I don't really get a new game. So I need to divide that 19 factorial by 3 factorial for the mines. Now the other resources, there are I think 4, there are only 3 of the hills. So there's another divide by 3 factorial. The other ones are all 4, so there are 3 of those. So I need to divide by 3 factorial, 3 factorial, 4 factorial, 4 factorial, 4 factorial. And that will give me the total number of... So let's just add that up. Make sure that 4 plus 4 plus 4, 12, plus 3, 15, plus 3, 18. You get, but there are 19. And that's because there's actually a little desert. If you generate the number 7, you'll see that 7 isn't anywhere here. It's the most common throw of the dice. And so that has a different function in the game. So that's given us our 19 hexagons, 19 factorial divided by 3 factorial squared divided by 4 factorial cubed. It's the total number of ways I can lay these hexagons down.
What number does that give us?
It gives us a very large number. And I think I remember when I calculated it, if we played a different game each night ever since the dinosaurs were around, we'd still be playing on different boards. So that's quite a lot of it. In fact, let's look it up because I did actually calculated in my new book about games. Here we go, my little hexagons. There are actually 244,432,188,000 different boards in that way. But actually, there is a little few more subtleties to this, which you have to take into account. So the way these numbers can be laid on the board, actually, it's a fixed way, but they can be rotated in 6 different ways. So actually you have to multiply up by another 6. And then there's another subtlety which I haven't talked about, which are little ports that you can land in, and they do different things in the game, which also determine another few factors more of the way that you can play this game. So there are a lot of games contained in this one single box.
Is Catan a game where people debate strategy or...
Yeah, there's a lot of debate of strategy about where to place your properties as you're settling Catan. And so that's important to look at these numbers because you want to go places where you're more likely to be generating resources because of where you've placed your properties. There's also another part of the game, which is laying roads. So you're interested in making the longest road, and that wins you things in the game. And so, again, there's an interesting strategy about how am I actually going to lay roads through this tessellation of hexagons. What's the longest road that's possible in the Settlers of Catan? That's another nice little mathematical challenge.
Professor, you're a mathematician and you like playing games. Do you often play games with other mathematicians?
Yes, because very often people who are not mathematicians get wise to the fact that this guy seems to have some tricks up his sleeve. And I often find my children have stopped playing games where I have a kind of an advantage because of my mathematical goggles. But a lot of mathematicians love playing games. But I think you'll find that many mathematicians do not like a game which involves any element of chance. They like it to be pure strategy. So games like chess or the game of Go, Chinese game of Go. Intriguingly, though, chess originally came from India and it actually involved dice. So the early versions of chess, you would throw a dice in order to determine which piece you were allowed to move. And then the use of dice and gambling was banned in India and people had to take these dice away. And then they thought, actually, we can just play this as a pure strategy game. So I think people might be surprised to learn, one of the things I learned when writing this book about games is that actually dice were part of chess originally.
Have you ever played a game of chess using that rule? That'd be amazing.
Yeah, I think it's a bit rubbish, actually, because, you know, you're really wanting to move your knight and the roll of the dice is forcing you to move the rook. And there's another interesting thing I discovered about chess, which is it wasn't a two-player game originally, but a four-player game. And actually, you can see that in the game that survived, because your army consists of two knights, two bishops, two rooks. And the point is that you actually captured one of the other players' armies and it became part of your army. And that's why you see these doubling up of pieces in the game.
Do you know what I would love to know? Because I'm not good at chess, right? I know the rules, but I'm not. If I played against Magnus Carlsen, a game of chess, where I could move any piece and he could only move pieces determined by dice, who would win the game?
I think it's a really interesting experiment. Yeah, we should set that up and just see, you know, how much of a handicap is it to be forced to play certain pieces in the game. I think for me as well, chess suffers a little bit because anyone who knows their openings actually has such a big advantage. So they can get to a place in the game. If you don't know your openings, you're already weak after 11 moves, which is why sometimes I think if you're playing somebody who's really good at chess, it's probably good to start in mid-game and start from both armies being in a strong position because of a Sicilian defence, for example.
If you're a fan of games, check out today's episode sponsor, Jane Street. They love games. So much, in fact, they've even invented one. More about that in a sec. Jane Street's a quantitative trading firm with offices all around the world. You see there. Now, obviously, they're passionate about solving high-stakes, complex problems. It's part of their business. They're experts at machine learning, mathematics, statistics, all that kind of stuff. And that problem-solving passion extends to puzzles and games. The team at Jane Street often spend free time playing each other at chess and Go and, yes, even Catan. And they created this card game called Figgy to simulate elements of markets and trading. It looks pretty cool, something you might be into. You can play it online at figgy.com. So why don't you go and have a look at that? And while you're there, check out Jane Street as a place where you might like to work. As you can see, they've got all sorts of jobs, internships, training programs available. There's always new stuff coming up on the site. Check it out, janestreet.com, or see the links in the video description. I've got the link to Jane Street and Figgy down there. Check out more videos with Marcus de Sortoy. You know he's really into games. In fact, he's got a new book out at the moment called Around the World in 80 Games. I'm also going to link to that in the video description.
Interested as a sculptor in, yeah, well, what about taking this atomic shape, the tetrahedron, and seeing what you can build?
This was mathematicians' hope that, okay, There's some weird logical gadillion sentences, which who really cares about?